Yeah, I just need to know what my expectations are.
Yeah.
Christmas Eve was the service I had in the school at Hall.
Oh, shit.
So I did the 5 minutes.
Well, that was last year.
No, no.
Believe me, we're all trying to pull together, man.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate it.
Do you have a song for already?
I'm assuming it's probably going to be all traditions.
Okay.
So, you know, probably O Holy Night, probably Silent Night.
Okay.
Awesome.
Definitely Silent Night.
Yeah,
it's got to be the candle and the light raising it up.
I really love First Noel. I'd love to do it. We have that old version of Hark the Herald Angels. I didn't love that one. They're really like upbeat one. I love just the traditional.
I prefer traditional.
Yeah.
For that setting.
Yeah.
I always a little town festival in my
room. Ooh, okay, yeah. I forgot about that.
But I mean, if you need a dozen one, I don't have that.
Let me.
And what town is this?
Let me pull that one in. In the morning, right? And we just have the 7 o'clock.
You can be off the morning. If you want to be there to sing, that'd be great. But I don't have an organ.
Oh.
All right, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Bexley United Methodist. It's great to have you with us this morning. Let's go ahead and rise. We're going to start off with just a traditional Christmas hymn here. Come, Thou Long Expected Jesus. Oh, I'll wait for us to have slides. This one? I can't see Kyle. Oh, there we go. All right, here we go. Come, thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people.
people free from our fears and sins. Release us, let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art, dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. Want thy people to deliver, born a child and yet a king, born to reign in us forever, now thy gracious kingdom bring. By thine own eternal Spirit, rule in all our hearts alone. By thine own sufficient merit, raise us to thy glorious throne.
Having one service at 10 a.m., and you'll be in the sanctuary, and it'll be less formal than normal sanctuary service, but one service at 10 a.m., and there'll be banners out to remind you. And then the service that'll be in the Maloney Center is at 7 p.m. in the evening. So we'll be doing both, and of course, you're welcome to both. The 5 o'clock service is the one that will have the children's pageant. And then the 7 and 9 o'clock services will be candlelight services. Today, after the 11 o'clock service, we're just having a reception to thank Elizabeth Murphy for her time on staff here. And you're welcome to come back for that. You also could put a card, leave a card here for her, because we're doing a card shower to give her thanks for the good work that she's done. And Scott,
yes.
Did you have an announcement about youth Christmas party?
Yeah, youth Christmas party from 4 to 6 at my house.
Okay.
I'll have food and a white elephant gift.
Today.
Today.
At
4 to 6.
Okay. All right. Let's have a spirit of prayer. Dear God, we thank you for this joyous season, and for the preparations we've been making. Our hearts are anxious to welcome you. We ask that you and the power of your Holy Spirit will come and join us in our worship now. Lift up our hearts and open up our minds that we might receive your truth. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
What child is this? Shepherds watch our keeping. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of to breathe. peasant came to own him, the King of Kings salvation brings. Let loving hearts enthrone him. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm a storm with his hand? Did you know
Christ came to bring us salvation and has promised to come again. Let us pray we may always be ready to welcome him. That the keeping of Advent may open our hearts to God's love. that the light of Christ may penetrate the darkness of sin.
Children's moment. So now's that time if all the kids want to come down for children's moment.
Come on up. Hi. Whoa, I'm loud. Normally I'm loud. This is too loud. Great. Good morning. So let's say our memory verse. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice glad in it. Very good. Today, I have a book that I want to share with you, and so everybody can see it. It's going to be up on the screen. And this storybook is about when Jesus was born, and it was written and illustrated by one of the most famous illustrators of children's literature in Australia. Her name is Julie Vivas, and she imagined the story of Jesus' birth with the Aboriginal people of her country as the characters in the story. And I love this book because it reminds us that we don't have a picture of Jesus in the nursery, do we? I mean, we don't have a picture when he was a baby. And so everyone gets to imagine Jesus as a baby in their own likeness. And since we're made in God's likeness, I just think that is a wonderful, wonderful gift. So I'm going to narrate. Can you see over my head? Okay. And here we go. Whoops. That's Cheryl. Oh my goodness. There's the angel Gabriel. In the days of Herod the king, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to the city of Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph. And the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel said to her, "Hail, the Lord is with thee. Thou art special among women." And then she saw him. When she saw him, she was troubled. The angel said, "Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. Thou hast bring forth a son and call him Jesus." It came to pass that Caesar Augustus decreed that all the world should be taxed. Everybody went to their own city. So Joseph went from Nazareth to the city of Bethlehem with Mary, his wife, and she was great with child. Do you think there's any room in the inn? No, the inn is really crowded. And so it was that time while they were there that the day came when she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Now, There were in the same country shepherds in the field, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said, "Fear not, for I bring you tidings of great joy. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host. When the angels were gone, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go into Bethlehem to see this thing which has come to pass." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And behold, there came wise men to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he that is born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star, and we have come to worship him." And lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it stood over where the young child was. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And they opened their treasures. They presented unto him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. The wise men departed into their own country, and the shepherds also returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen. And the child was called Jesus, which was so named by the angel, before he was conceived in the womb. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for Jesus. Help me to live like him. Amen.
At this time, I'd like to invite you to greet one another and share the love of Christ. Pass the peace. Hello. Hello. La 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 la, ah la la la, it's time to pray. Hallelujah. I used to get my kids to, when they would not be listening to me, I would do that, and oh, sometimes it worked and sometimes it didn't. And I can't do this with the 11 o'clock bulletin either. Are there joys and concerns that you would like to share with each other?
Good to be back in the house of the Lord.
It's good to be back in the house of the Lord. Thank you. Lord, hear our prayers. I have a few that I know. I would like for us to pray for healing for Roger Steffi, who's having surgery tomorrow. After a fall. So for Roger and his procedure to be successful and safe, Lord, hear our prayers. One more. And I also want us to pray for Jeremy Jones, who is in has a diagnosis of very aggressive cancer, young man, 33 years old, and in need of a miracle of healing. So, Lord, hear our prayers. Sorry, go ahead, Cheryl. Yeah. For Kate's good recovery coming along and continued prayers, Lord, hear our prayers. Other? Right, for a great nephew who's had surgery and is successfully, Lord, hear our prayers of thanks.
Justin finished his welding school on Friday and graduated really well, some 3.5 or 3, almost 3.8, maybe something around there. He he moved back yesterday and he has his first interview on Tuesday.
All right, so Justin is back home having successfully completed his welding degree and has his first interview. So there's joys and supplications in there. Lord, hear our prayers. Other, yeah? So for prayers for a niece who's recovered, recovering well from being in the hospital with RSV, was it? And for Amy's surgery and the love and care that has been surrounding her. Lord, hear our prayers. Others? Okay. I know that you continue to pray for peace in our world and I sometimes feel like speechless when I watch the news. I don't know about you, but we can pray and we should pray that our world will become more peaceful and that we'll study war no more. And God be with us as we do that. Let's be in a spirit of prayer. Dear God, you come in such unexpected ways into the world that you made and that you love. In the form of a person, as a baby, to a young girl who is not married, It's so hard to believe. And so we put up lots of lights and we give gifts and we do all kinds of things to celebrate. And sometimes we lose sight of just the wonder of the birth, of the coming into the world of your son to share our lives, to share our heartaches, our challenges, our suffering, our joys, relationships, in fact, to shape all of life in a different way because we know we are part of his kingdom. And so we ask that as we come into a closer time of celebration, that you will help us be born anew in him, that the King will once again take the throne of our hearts, and in our church, that we might be a kingdom people, more committed than ever to living out his love and truth and goodness in service to God, to one another in this world. We ask it in the name of the one who came and taught us to pray, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So these last few Sundays, we've been learning about some of the people who were witnesses to the incarnation, to that entry of God into the world. And we've talked about Zechariah and Elizabeth, the parents of John, who became the Baptist. And today we're going to talk about Mary. And I am going to share a passage that is so familiar to you. And then we're going to look at a few depictions of it in art. And then we're going to think together about this concept that will be introduced, that was introduced by some of the mystics of the past, by Teresa of Avila, by Thomas Merton, the virgin point. So here's Luke's story of the Annunciation. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I'm a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you, and therefore the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month for her who is said to be barren, for nothing will be impossible with God." And then Mary said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And then the angel departed from her. So the first slide that we have up here is a 15th century painting of called The Annunciation. And this is by Antonello da Messina. And you'll notice here we have Mary in the blue that she is traditionally now associated with, but in other centuries, this was not necessarily the case. One thing you will notice about Mary is that she's at a book reading that's almost definitely a scripture, which would not include the New Testament, would have been the Hebrew Bible. And if we could, I wish we could zoom in close, but that is a face, I think, maybe of perplexity. Oh, thank you. We did zoom in. Very good, Kyle. In this depiction from the 1970s in Cameroon, a community in Cameroon does these paintings. It looks like Mary is kind of caught in the middle of everyday activities where she's getting ready to cook over a fire. Those hands up like that suggest caught off guard, maybe a little bit worried, kind of not a distressed look on her face, but kind of caution, stay back a little bit, I'm not sure about this. You can fill in your own words as you look at it. This next one is one of my favorites. This is by Henry Osawa Tanner from 1898. He was the first African-American artist to achieve international acclaim in his day. And here you see Mary looking kind of shy and awkward, and her hands might be clasped in what suggested maybe she was praying at the time. I love this depiction of the angel as this column of pulsating energy and light. That's kind of, to me, what an angel would be like. And almost no one else does angels like this. So I thought that was pretty cool. Just to take you a little bit here, this is a depiction of the angel Gabriel that's on the walls in the Church of St. Gabriel the Archangel in Colorado Springs, Colorado, 1998. And there are some other different depictions of the angel Gabriel. Most angels in the Bible don't have names. Gabriel gets named. This is a stained glass window called the Annunciation from 1950. It's at a church in Swaffham, England. And here, Mary seems just in awe and wonder and praise and very, very open, almost like, put me in, coach, I'm ready. This is El Greco, a late 16th or early 17th century painting. It's interesting, I don't know if you can see it very well. El Greco paints almost like little flies buzzing around her head. He doesn't do a full halo. It's as if, you know, it's not fully formed yet. And there you see the Holy Spirit is coming down like a dove. Lilies are going to be in a couple of the paintings. We associate lilies with the resurrection, but at this point in time, they were mostly associated with purity. So it's emphasizing the purity of Virgin Mary. You can't see it very well, but when I was zooming in really closely, down at the bottom, kind of an interesting, looks out of place down there. There's a little vase that has some kind of wildflower in it. And if you look at it closely, it looks like they're flaming, but not burning up, which is kind of like the bush that Moses saw that was burning but wasn't being consumed. And I think that's another sign. El Greco's put it in there to say this is a theophany. God is God himself this is highly significant. And of course, there she is also looking at scriptures. And that's interesting because it's highly unlikely that Mary would have been able to read. Literacy was very low anyway in that time, and especially with women. She, as a peasant woman, she would not have been taught to read. But they're doing that to emphasize the connection. If we were going to be able to zoom in on those scriptures, she would have the book of Isaiah open, where the foretelling of the virgin bearing a son. I really think this one's interesting. This is from 1882. There again, the lilies are appearing, and Gabriel looks to me almost more like Gabrielle, and is giving lilies to what looks to be like a very frightened teenager, like really huddled. What in the world is going on? This next one, you also see the angel giving lilies, but here Mary looks like the queen, and the angel is taking almost a position that would be prostrate before the angel, before Mary. And so here she's already depicted kind of as a queen of heaven. You can see up in the left corner, the Holy Spirit, the dove coming down, that's the conception by the Holy Spirit. Here's another El Greco one. He painted the Annunciation more than once. And I liked this again. Mary looks a little bolder in this one. She's reading. It's neat how he shows the angel kind of in a cloud of dust lifting above. What I really think is interesting about this, though, is when you go, I'm going to give you an up close. If you go back, this is up in the heavens. These spirit beings look like those dark clouds are swirling with white clouds. It looks like these spiritual beings are kind of maybe arguing with each other about, is this crazy or what? What is God doing? This is nuts. And just like, how's this all going to pan out? And we're so used to thinking about the Christmas story in a mundane way. It probably doesn't strike us as crazy, but it's kind of crazy. This one is, I think, interesting because it is from the 1300s, and Mary is on the second from the right, and the angel is bowing down before her. Also, there are lilies there and a lot of symbolism, but if you zoom in to see Mary's face, she does not look terribly pleased about all this. And art historians suggest that maybe Mary is being protective because she was noted as a Virgin Mary, and at many points her virginity was emphasized as purity and almost disdain for sexuality, right? So, ooh, I have to get pregnant? There is another completely different artist also doing that kind of like, stay away. So, Thomas Merton is pictured there, and also Teresa of Avila. And in Thomas Merton's writings, the Advent study that we've been doing points out that he has this concept that emerges in his writing and also in Teresa of Avila of, and I'm going to try to say it in French, but basically the English is the virgin point. Le point vierge. Close? Le point vierge. I speak Spanish, not French. So anyway. But the idea, we oftentimes think about virginity in a very physical way, this affirming that it's a miracle that the Holy Spirit was the source of the conception of Jesus and Mary. And that is true, perfectly legitimate. But for the mystics, this becomes more significant. The virgin point is a way of talking about the point at which people meet God in a real and experimental contact. Or we might think about it, the point at which conversion of the human heart begins. It's maybe like the point in which we say yes to God for God's purposes. We think about virginity as being something referring to biology, but in another sense, it's also just about not having experience of something, so that something completely new is happening, of which you are completely unprepared, and it's a new adventure. And of course, for Mary, the biggest adventure of her life was to be in partnership with God in this awesome work of renewing creation by sending his son. So the different expressions that Mary had in artwork, as people think about that, in part is how do we feel about the idea of when we meet with God and begin a new adventure. So we talked in our class about how have you experienced the virgin point in your life, the time when conversion begins or when you say yes to God. And people talked about, well, that sometimes happens at a point when we really need God, when we're at our wit's end, we don't know where we're going to turn for healing or for help or strength or for peace of mind. So it can be like saying yes in a point of powerlessness and need. And I imagine that was probably very much in a way the way Mary was feeling. We also talked about sometimes that saying yes is about I'm willing to serve, and it starts a new adventure. It's been a couple of Christmases ago when Francis Quinn came to his first Christmas Eve service at an extremely low point in his life of health. His wife had died just a few months before. His own health was terribly imperiled. And he was crying as he called the church to find out when the Christmas Eve services were. And came that night, and the secretary had alerted me to look for him, and I did find him, and we started talking. And he very quickly said that he wanted to become involved at the church and do some things to help lead. And one of the things that we were working on right then was the first English meal, and I needed help, and so I asked Francis about it, and he said yes. And so the first meal after that was being taken to First English, Francis bought the items on the list for a vegetable tray that I gave him, and he was really good at enlisting others to help, so he pulled Lynn Swisher in really quickly. And they were going to get things ready on a Thursday afternoon at about 3, and I got down there a little bit late. And when I walked in, I saw these two gentlemen with a whole bunch of carrots, like pounds and pounds of carrots, which we need for that thing. And they had their carrots were like twice the size of this, and they were cutting them in chunks like this, like, Bugs Bunny, what's up, Doc? For this meal tray. And he had raw zucchini to cut up for the tray too, which I don't usually associate with vegetable trays. And I just sat there and looked at him and I said, you guys, what's with this carrot, like this huge chunk? And I realized, what did I do? I asked them to lead this, and they have no idea what they are doing. And that became clear, and they learned, but it became clear. I was like, oh my gosh, these guys said that they would lead this meal, and they don't know, they don't even know how to peel carrots right and make carrot sticks. I didn't think anybody had to learn that. But then it occurred to me, they were virgin cooks. But they said yes. They said yes. And they got started on the adventure, and they pulled more people in. So I think sometimes being at the virgin point in your life is just saying, well, yes, we'll figure it out together. I think sometimes, like Mary, all of that comes mixed in with the sense of being just so blessed. So blessed. Because at that point in your life, you know that whatever you're undertaking, you're doing it with God and for God. And whereas before you felt alone and without power, you may still feel like you don't know which direction you're going in, but you have the best company of all. And that's what I think about when I remember Mary. She just said yes, had no idea how it was all going to work out. It could not have looked promising, but she knew she was blessed because whatever was going to happen, she had the very best companion and guide and instructor. So where are you? Have you had virgin points in your life where you've said yes to God? And where your heart begins to change. And if not, maybe sometime soon, you'll have the experience of taking the next step of a wonderful adventure, and you will be blessed in that. May it be so. Amen.
All right, let's go ahead and stand. We'll sing our final song. This is a song that I discovered just a couple years ago and really kind of fell in love with. It's called Noel. And to us a child is born, and he shall reign forevermore.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up the light of his presence upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.